da Worley Parsons, nos presenteiam com essa palestra. Ele veio da Austrália, a gente está chegando hoje no Brasil, e especialmente para fazer essa palestra para vocês. Isso para nós é uma honra, porque eles têm uma bagagem muito grande, uma experiência que eu acho bastante relevante para o processo que a gente vem desenvolvendo aqui dentro da GV, no programa Empresas pelo Clima. Hoje, então, a gente recebe o Sr. Paul Hardesty, e eu vou apresentar para vocês brevemente o vasto currículo dele. Ele é diretor de sustentabilidade global e economics da empresa Worley Parsons, e é também o gestor geral mundial dos serviços gerais de gestão de carbono, e que é um projeto que apoia os clientes em todo o mundo para gerarem respostas aos desafios ambientais, sociais e econômicos nos seus projetos de sustentabilidade. O Sr. Paul é uma referência também acadêmica, ele tem uma grande produção. O novo livro dele, que está para sair, eu vou anunciar para vocês daqui a pouco o título, e é um professor que tem atuado em várias universidades. Atualmente, ele é professor adjunto de Hidrologia Ambiental no Imperial College de Londres, e também é professor adjunto na Universidade da Western Australia, então na escola de administração do Western Australia University, e é professor de sustentabilidade lá, e ele é professor em vários MBAs também nesse tema da sustentabilidade. O livro que ele está lançando sobre economia e sustentabilidade para a indústria vai ser publicado em breve pela editora CRC. Eu acho que em breve a gente pode, quando tiver lançado o livro, se a Dani puder nos avisar, a gente indica para vocês a publicação. Ele mora em Perth, na Austrália, com sua esposa e seus dois filhos. E ele é um Ironman triatleta. E ele também contribui para um programa muito bacana do ex-presidente Gorbachev, que se chama Climate Change Task Force. Então, a gente tem a honra. Thank you very much for coming. It's an honor for us to have you here.
Muito prazer a todos. I speak, my first language is French, c'est ma langue maternelle, but that's not going to do me much good. My Portuguese isn't very good at all, but thank you very much for coming, I appreciate it. Not only of what we're doing inside Worley Parsons, but what we're doing for our customers in managing carbon and climate change issues. So really, the idea is to talk a little bit about carbon economics, which is the service that Worley Parsons has developed to help our customers manage these issues, and then to move very quickly into a number of case histories. And a key theme I'd like to mention is the second bullet point there, is that when we look at the economics of climate change management, one of the things we have to get, I think is very, very important, is that it's not only about cost, and believe it or not, it's not only about carbon. And I'll show you how that works in a second. I've got three examples. If I have time, I'll get through all of them. If I have to go slowly, I can always eliminate one example and finish up so that everybody can get home on time. First, I'd just like to start. I'm not going to give a lot of background. I understand here that everybody here is one way or another involved with climate change, so I'm not going to give a bunch of technical background on the science or anything else. I'm just going to say that if you look at this particular series of quotes are from the International Energy Agency and the OECD in the World Energy Outlook 2009, just been published. Now, if you just quickly read those quotes, I won't read them for you. What these tell me is that the world is changing, and despite the apparent failure of Copenhagen, I was there for 2 weeks. It was a very interesting time. It was very cold as well, ironically. Things are changing, and they're going to keep changing quickly over the next 10 to 20 years, and so we're starting that journey. But that kind of language is very telling. This is a very conservative group, and they're using words like catastrophe, irreversible damage, the world's energy system being patently unsustainable. So this is not really news to anybody, I think, who's working in this area, but this is intended for a very wide audience. And what does it mean? Well, it means that if you look at a number of studies around the world, if you look at many analysts' view on where the costs of carbon on the vertical axis and tons of CO2, dollars per ton of CO2 equivalent, I'm using US dollars here, and being a Canadian, it's always a little bit frustrating that I have to use American dollars, but there you go, nobody knows our money. And now I live in Australia, it's the same thing. In fact, I was told the population of Sao Paulo today, and when I was speaking to my young son on the phone this morning back in Australia, I said, I am in a city that has as many people as the entire population of my country, of my new country, Australia, in one city. This is amazing. No wonder the traffic's so difficult. But nonetheless, this black wedge here gives a kind of totalized view of what many analysts in the world think is going to happen to the real price of carbon in terms of the price that organizations are going to have to pay in one way or another over the next 40 years or so. And one thing you can see is that there's a lot of uncertainty, but the trend is up. And I'll come back to this in a little while. Now, one of the things that I'm sure you all know is that companies around the world, and this is just a very small selection of firms that we work with on a regular basis in Worley Partsons, and these are companies that are all listed on the Dow Jones Sustainability Index, the stock market index in New York, and they're voluntarily reporting on their sustainability performance, which includes things like how they're managing their carbon emissions and their greenhouse gas footprint. So this is not an isolated thing. It's big, it's worldwide, and there's very, very many firms that are taking this issue very seriously, including Vale, Petrobras, and others that we work for on a regular basis.